قل هذه سبيلي أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة أنا ومن اتبعني وسبحان الله وما أنا من المشركين.
والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. جزاكم الله خير brothers for giving me that very warm reply by saying وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. Earlier today I gave a short reminder, and the short reminder I gave, among the things I mentioned, was that أفشوا السلام بينكم, to spread the word of السلام among ourselves. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us in a hadith, if you say assalamu alaykum, that means you will have 10 rewards. If you say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, you'll have 20. If you have assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, you're gonna have 30. Because one day when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sat in the masjid, he was among his companions, a man came in and he said assalamu alaykum, and the Prophet said wa alaykum assalam, and then he said ashara. The companions didn't know why the Prophet said 10. Everybody was quiet. And then another person came, and that person said assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, and the Prophet said wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah, and then the Prophet said 20, and then he sat down. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, another person came and he said assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, and the Prophet said 30. That means he got the full ajr, mashallah. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Jazakum Allah khairan. At least we know that we have 30 rewards, inshallah. Alhamdulillah. To start with, I want to say Jazakallah khair to our Shaykh, mashallah, who has delivered a very beautiful reminder. Unfortunately, I didn't understand anything about it. It was beautiful though. I could tell it was nice, mashallah. I was able to pick up, although I came last minute, I joined you at the last minute. But also I understood, mashallah, some of the, mashallah, adilla and the evidences the Shaykh was using in Arabic. And it was beautiful, mashallah. Jazakallah khair. Shaykh Abu Mu'adh. And bi'innillahi ta'ala, we're going to begin our discussion tonight, or our short reminder. And this is going to be a reminder for myself before anybody else. Because when we give a reminder, it's not for you guys. Not only for you, it's also for the person who's giving it. So the giver is going to benefit, the receiver is also going to benefit. So inshallah ta'ala, is going to be a mutual benefit for all of us, inshallah ta'ala. All of us, before we begin, I want to remind myself and you guys as well, and the sisters at the back. I want to remind everyone, all of us, inshallah ta'ala, if we do what we're doing right now for Allah, we're going to get ajr for it. Al-ikhlas, very, very important. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said? Innama al-a'malu bin-niyat. Innama al-a'malu bin-niyat. According to our intention. Do you know right now we prayed salah? Some of us will get more reward for the salah than others. Why? It was all about the intention, the focusness, al-khushu'. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. What is the next ayah? أَلَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. How much khushu' did we have? Who can tell me what surah I read in the salah? Ah, you see? Who can remember what I read the first rak'ah? Who can remember what I read the second rak'ah? MashaAllah, Sheikh Abdullah, I'm not going to give you the chance. I'm going to give it to other people. So inshallah ta'ala, who can remember what I read at the beginning? What was the first rak'ah? MashaAllah, at the Sheikh, is that Abu Talha? Ah, MashaAllah, he's my friend. I met him today, MashaAllah, Abu Talha Al-Guthumbegi. How are you, brother Abu Talha? Okay, give it to me. Do you remember the first ayat? Ma asaba min musibatin, MashaAllah. كأنك قلتها ما شاء الله بالنقل نقلا ما شاء الله ومعنى بالمعنى ما شاء الله ما أصابك من مصيبة إلا بإذن الله سبحان الله. These ayat are very powerful if we paid attention, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was telling us. I purposely read these ayat. I deliberately read these ayat. Why? Because we need to remind ourselves all the time. ما أصابك من مصيبة إلا بإذن الله. Whatever trials we are afflicted with, anything that happens to us, it only happens to us because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already written it. He has written it. ما أصاب من مصيبة إلا بإذن الله. Another ayah that I read, subhanallah, what did Allah say, subhanahu wa ta'ala? وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ. Obey Allah and obey who else? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sheikh Abu Mu'adh was saying, the hadith he was quoting, the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ أَمْرَيْنِ. I left with you two things, very important. Al-Qur'an was sunnah. Al-Qur'an was sunnah, very, very important. Therefore, my brothers and sisters in Islam, our reminder tonight, insha'Allah ta'ala, is gonna be around different topics. It's gonna be, you know, some people are only boxers. You know, some people, all they do is boxing. They don't know how in any other way to fight. They just do boxing. Some people, they only do kickboxing. That's how they know it. Some people, they are known as freestyle fighters. Freestyle. When they fight, they can fight on the ground. They can fight standing up. Do you know, like the UFC? Yeah. You guys, you have a good fighter, do you know? He's not the heavyweight champ, but he was like, what was his name? Gustafsson, yes. He's the man. Do you know, I met him. Last time I came to Sweden, where was I going? I was coming to Sweden, yes. I think it was Stockholm I was coming to. So I met him in the plane because we were actually on the same flight. And I know him from the UFC, you know? So I said to him, I gave him a salam. I said to him, how you doing, man? I said, I'm doing well. I was wearing my khamis, my big hat, you know, looking like an African chief, you know? Sudan Somaliyat Baraka. And I said, how you doing, chief? How you doing, boss? He said, all right, I'm doing fine. And I said to him, do you know who I am? He said, I don't know who you are. But I said to him, I know you though. Because I know you are a good fighter and I don't want to fight you right now. And I'm not going to challenge you, you know. I'm not Joe Jones, I said to him. I'm not Joe Jones because his opponent was Joe Jones and he gave him a good fight. Because he's a great fighter. How many of you are UFC, mashallah, fans? Raise your hand. Mashallah, I can see a few people, mashallah. That guy is a good fighter, you know. So the reminder, why did I bring about this issue? I said the reminder is going to be a freestyle reminder. I'm not going to be focused on one issue. I'm going to be talking about different things. So please, if you lose me, forgive me, all right? If you lose me, where did he go, the sheikh? Why, we can't find him. What is he talking about? We don't understand what he's talking about. Please forgive me. I say, okay, we will forgive him. Because he told us from the beginning, this is a disclaimer. I told you from the beginning, I am going to talk about different things, different issues. And inshallah ta'ala, I hope it will make sense. So inshallah ta'ala, everybody who's here right now is going to benefit something. Inshallah ta'ala, when you leave the masjid tonight, you're going to say, alhamdulillah, we did benefit something. Okay, is that all right? Is that a deal? Khalas, mashallah. We are in for a fight now. So, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, I'm going to begin with this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us that this life, the life that we're living today, is a challenge. Allah, He didn't keep it secret. He told us very clearly. He said, this life is a challenge. This life is a test. I want to speak to the young brothers and the young sisters and all the older brothers, all the brothers who are here and the parents. Everybody is included, inshallah ta'ala. Because when Allah created life, He didn't create the life only for the young people. He created life for everybody. And this life is a test for all of us. So inshallah ta'ala, I am going to begin by saying the following. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran and He asked us this question. أَفَمَنْ يَمْشِي مُكِبًّا عَلَى وَجْهِهِ أَهْدَى أَمَّنْ يَمْشِي سَوِيًّا عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Imagine, I just want you to imagine someone. If someone, when he walks or she walks, they walk with their face down on the floor. Imagine if I have my head on the floor right now and my feet are up in the air, just like that, and I'm walking on the street. Am I going to walk fast or am I going to be in trouble? I'm not going to walk fast, am I? Will I see where I'm going? I'm not going to see where I'm going because this part of my head is going to be facing that way. I'm not going to see where I'm going. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, that person who walks like that, or a person who's upright, standing up like this, and that he's walking, are these two people equal? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, أَفَمَنْ يَمْشِي مُكِبًّا عَلَى وَجْهِهِ أَهْدَى أَمَّنْ يَمْشِي سَوِيًّا عَلَى صِرَاطٍ. Who's more guided? Who's going to be the person who's going to have a better walk? Who's the person who's going to reach his destination before the other? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us that who that person is. أَفَمَنْ يَمْشِي مُكِبًّا عَلَى وَجِهِ أَهْدَاءً مَنْ يَمْشِي سَوِيًّا عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Subhanallah. It's a very powerful ayah. Very, very powerful ayah. So each and every one of us right now, we need to ask ourselves, when we walk, how do we walk? Am I the person who's walking with his head down? Or am I the person who's walking with his feet down on the floor, firm on the ground, and my head up, and my eyes focused, and I'm able to see where I'm going? And the Shaykh Jazahullah Khair Abu Mu'ad, he was reading very beautiful ayah, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. If you have a beautiful soul, if you have a soul that is really a life, a living soul, a soul which is a good soul, what's going to happen? You're going to try and purify your soul. You're going to make yourself, mashallah, much better than many other people. So this is about the soul, which is the righteous soul, bi'inillahi ta'ala. So right now, my brothers and sisters in Islam, I want to narrate to you a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتِ. What did the Prophet say? اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتِ. All of us right now, we are in the masjid. All of us right now, we are in the masjid. We are fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have taqwa in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we're in the masjid. But what about when you are outside of the masjid? What about when you go to college? What about when you go to the school? What about when you go to the university? What about when you are in your own private room? Do you fear Allah? Do you think about Allah? Do you think about Allah when your parents are not watching you? When your parents are not looking at you that time? When your father is not aware of where you are? When you are able to lie to your mother? When you are able to lie to your elders? Do you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What did Allah, the Prophet said? اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُ مَا كُنْتَ. Fear Allah wherever you are. What's going to happen if you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah will protect you. Allah is going to protect you in this life and the hereafter. Also, my brothers and sisters in Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. If we did something wrong, we have to do something right behind it, straight away. If you commit a sin, don't just continue committing that sin and say, I did it anyway, so I don't care, I'm just going to do it again. No, say, I want to make tawbah to Allah. Quick tawbah. Because quick tawbah is very, very important. What did the Prophet say? وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ. When you did something wrong and you did something right straight behind it, what's going to happen? It will wipe it away. وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. Another important advice the Prophet gave us. وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. When you deal with the people, deal with them in a good manner. The way you would like them to deal with you, okay? You want everybody to tell you the truth, you tell everybody the truth. You want everybody to be kind to you, be kind to everybody. You want everybody to look after you, look after everybody else. You want everybody to be friendly with you, be friendly with everybody else. You want everybody to take your back, to protect you from behind. You protect other people from the back, from their backs. From behind, protect them. Don't allow somebody to backbite someone else in front of you. Don't allow somebody else what? To backbite someone else in front of you. For example, if somebody starts talking about somebody, a group of people, sometimes now Muslims these days, unfortunately, what do we have? We have group riba. What is it known as? Group riba, where we commit backbiting as a group. One person is just going to start talking and it's going to say, do you know what? Such and such is something, someone bad. Such a group is very bad group. Such a tribe is very bad tribe. And nobody says anything. We just listen. Say, yeah, you're right, man. You're right. What are you doing that time? Imagine if somebody was talking about you that time. Wouldn't you want somebody to protect you when you were not there? You would have wanted somebody to tell other people, stop talking about these people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he promise us? He promised us, if you look after the honor of other people, Allah will look after your honor. What? If you look after the honor of other people, Allah will look after your honor. Allah will look after it. If you protect other people when they're not present, Allah will protect your honor when you're not present. That's the beauty, mashallah, of our religion. Also, my brothers and sisters in Islam, what I want to talk about here tonight also, young people these days, they are very confused. Very confused. They say, probably young people, they come to me all the time. Ya Muhammad Ali, they ask me questions. I see them. I can see these things from their eyes and from their faces. I can tell. Young people are saying, we are absolutely confused because everybody is telling us something different. Let me say this to you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, مَا مِن زَمَن إِلَّا الَّذِي بَعْدَهُ أَشَرٌ مِنْ. There's no time except the time that comes after it is actually more serious. It's just going to get worse. Subhanallah. It's just going to get worse. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that. And let me say this to you. What the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said. What I'm going to say to you is just what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, لَيَأْتِيَنَّ عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٍ. People will come, a time will come to the people, or time will come, لَيَأْتِيَنَّ عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٌ where لَا يَدْرِ الْقَاتِلُ فِي مَقَتَلٍ وَلَا الْمَقْتُولُ فِي مَقْتُلٍ. This is how confusing the situation is. We are living at a time when the human being, when the believer, when the human being doesn't know if someone was killed, why he was killed. The one who killed him doesn't know why he killed him. The one who was killed doesn't know why he was killed. The Prophet ﷺ also told us, a time is going to come, يُصْبِحُ الرَّجُلُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا. Subhanallah. The Prophet ﷺ told us, a time is going to come when the person, in the morning he's a believer, in the afternoon he becomes a disbeliever. In the afternoon he's a Muslim, in the morning he becomes a disbeliever. It's a very confusing time. Very serious. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, a time is going to come, a man is going to be walking and he's going to see the graveyard. He's going to see al-qabr. He's going to see the qubur and he's going to say, I wish I was in that grave. I wish I was where? Alive or in the grave? I was in the grave. This is the time. It's the time. Very confusing. Very difficult. Because a lot of things are happening. But what is it that can keep us focused? What is it that can keep us calm and down to earth? What can give us peace of tranquility? Peace in our hearts and tranquility. What is it that can give us? The Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Al-Quran, Kitabullah. Kitabullah, very, very important. Can somebody give me the Mus'haf, please? Somebody pass me the Mus'haf. Very, very important. Jazakumullahu khairan. I need the Mus'haf. Barakallah fi kizir. Ikhwani, brothers and sisters, look at me, please. Do you know this Quran? This is one of the greatest gifts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. Wallahi, we should just open the Quran, read it through, try to understand it. But these days, unfortunately, we force our children. We say to our children as parents, I want my son to be Hafidhul Quran. We don't think about, do we want our children just to become Huffaz? Or do we want our children not to also to understand the Quran? I'm just going to give you one example. This Quran, when is it going to help us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكِ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. This Quran was not just revealed so we can memorize it. The Quran was revealed in order for what? لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. We need to pay attention to the Quran. We need to try and understand what the Quran means. I'm just going to give you one example. Do you know the companions? Uthman ibn Affan, Ubay ibn Ka'ab, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Those great companions. They told us how they memorized the Quran. They said, the Quran, when will the Quran be our solution? The Quran is going to be a solution for us, inshallah ta'ala, and the Sunnah of the Prophet. When will the Quran be our solution? Is when we learn it, understand it, practices it. Look at the companions, what they said. Uthman ibn Affan has said, whenever we wanted to learn the Quran, we would learn 8 ayat or 10 ayat. And these 10 ayat, when we memorize it, we try to understand what it means. After we understand what these ayat mean, we used to put them into practice. After we put them into practice, we used to come back for more. And I'll just give you one example. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Do you know how long it took him to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah? And learn Surah Al-Baqarah? It wasn't like, if I tell you right now, and I say to you, it took him that long, you're just going to say, Abdullah ibn Umar must have been thick. He must have been a dumb person. His hifd was poor. That's what you're going to say to me. But that's not the case. Abdullah ibn Umar, it took him 8 years to memorize only Surah Al-Baqarah. And how long is Surah Al-Baqarah? It's only 2 juz and less than a half. It's just 2.5 juz, maximum. That's how long Surah Al-Baqarah. It took him 8 years. But why did it take him 8 years? And the Salaf used to say, if somebody memorizes Al-Baqarah and Al Imran, he's like a alim. You should be alim if you know those two surahs. If you know and understand those surahs, you are alim. They used to consider them as ulama. But right now, we have many people who memorize this Quran, but they know nothing about the Quran. وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. This Quran is the solution. We said we are in a confused state. But what is going to help us is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But when will the Quran become our solution? When will the Quran help us be guided? I'm going to read it for you right now. I'm going to tell you some ayat you read every day. Not every day, but every year. At least once in your life every year. Every single year, once you read it. Or maybe twice, three times. Some of us, maybe we read it 10, 20 times a year, these ayat. But the question now is, do we understand what these ayat are saying? Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said. Alif Lam Mim. Thalika Al-Kitab. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? That book, there is no doubt in it. This Quran has no doubt in it. Nobody should ever tell you. If people tell you that the Quran, there's something wrong with the Quran, you need to tell them that they are absolutely telling something which is false. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا ريب فيه. There's nothing, there's no doubt in our Quran. Believe in that. You have to have that in your heart. Say, my Quran, I believe in it. The Quran, I believe in it. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. The Quran is guidance, is a path, is success for who? لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Who are the muttaqeen? Allah is immediately telling us who the muttaqoon are. Who are the pious people? Who are these people? Immediately, what ayah comes after the ayah? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. This is the question right now. How much do you believe about the ghaib? The people who believe, Allah said, the unseen. What makes us different from the rest of the people is because we believe the unseen. Alam al-ghaib. We believe the things that are unseen. Has anyone seen Allah? If you have seen Allah, please raise your hand. Anyone can raise their hand here and can say that I have seen Allah? Nobody can say that. Has anyone seen the Prophet? Anyone seen Prophet Muhammad who's sitting here today? No. Has anyone seen the angels? You can raise your hand if you have seen the angels. Nobody has seen. Has anyone seen Jannah? Please raise your hand. If anyone has seen Jannah, nobody. Has anyone seen hellfire? Nobody. We haven't seen hellfire. The people who are sitting here right now and listening to me, they haven't seen hellfire. But do we believe in hellfire? Do we believe in Jannah? Do we believe in Akhirah? Do we believe the Sirat? There's going to be Sirat above the hellfire? Do we believe that? Because the day is going to come, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, يَوْمَ تَرَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَسْعَى نُورُهُمْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَبِأَيْمَانِهِمْ بُشْرَاكُمْ الْيَوْمِ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. A day is going to come when the believing people, the believing men and women, what's going to happen? The light is going to be running, will be on their right hand side and left hand side. And light will be running in front of them. Where? To cross that bridge. There's going to be a bridge. Everybody who's going to go to Jannah has to go over that bridge. If you cannot go across that bridge, it means you're going to fall into the hellfire. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min jahannam. Say ameen. Very serious, ikhwani. What did Allah say? يَوْمَ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتِ. That day, the hypocrites. The people, do you know who the hypocrites are? The people who pretend. They make it to other people. Munafiq is somebody who hides or who shows and who makes it apparent to the people something which is very different to what he is holding in his heart. And guess what? Guess what? Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, the Sarir Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the companion that used to keep the secret of the Prophet ﷺ. You know Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, that great companion? He had the names of the munafiqeen. He had the names. The Prophet told him, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these people, they are munafiqeen. They act like Muslims, but they're not Muslims. Hudhayfa, when he was alive, you know what he said? He said the munafiqeen of today are worse than the munafiqeen of the time of the Prophet. And people have said to him, what do you mean by that? Why did he say the munafiqeen of today are worse? He said the munafiqeen of today, they make their situation clear to the people. They openly tell people that they're almost munafiqs. They come out. But the munafiqeen of the time of the Prophet, they used to keep it secret. But the ones that are alive that time, how long ago was this? This is like the time when Umar was alive. Umar radiallahu anhu was alive. Uthman ibn Affan was alive. Ali radiallahu anhu was alive. And he was saying that munafiqeen of that time were worse than the munafiqeen of Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. People like him. They're worse than the ones that existed that time, at the time of the Prophet. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? We believe al-ghayb. What was the point I was trying to make? We believe the ghayb. If you are a true believer, you have to believe everything that is going to happen in akhir. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. What is the characteristics of the people who will make use of the Quran? وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. We need to ask ourselves and say, are we really praying salah? Are we really establishing the prayer how it should be established? وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُونَ. Is that how is it going to be? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. They give what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to them. Some of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to them. What's the next characteristics? وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ. They believe what was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ. What was revealed to the Prophet was the Quran and the Sunnah. Both of them. And وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِن قَبْلِكَ. What was revealed to the Prophets who came before them. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. And they believe in Akhirah. Deep conviction. Wallahi, if we don't believe in Akhirah, we're not going to fear Allah. If you don't have iman, sincere iman, real iman in your heart about akhirah, you're not going to believe. You're not going to do something good. You're not going to be a righteous person. What did Allah say at the end? Ulaika ala hudan min rabbihim. Those people will be upon the guidance of Allah. So if we want to be upon the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if we want to be the successful people like Sheikh Abu Ma'ad was saying, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَاهَ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Those people are the successful people. May Allah make us among the successful people. Say Ameen. So you might be asking yourself right now this question. Muhammad Ali, we have heard what you've just said, and we've heard it many times. Do you have something else? Give us something else. Come on, you said you're a freestyle boxer, yeah? Or fighter. Give us something else. Why is it that the Muslims today are falling behind? Why are the Muslims disunited? Why are the Muslims not able to work together? Why are the Muslims are almost the lowest of the lowest? Why? Why is this? I am going to quote a very, very powerful thing right now. I'm going to give you a quote. And this quote is mentioned by Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, from a great alim, Shaqiq ibn Ibrahim. And I'm going to do it for you right now. And I want you to remember these six things. These six things, I want you to remember them. And these are the following. Shaqiq ibn Ibrahim has said, أُغْلِقَ بَابُ التَّوْفِيقَ عَنِ الْخَلْقِ فِي سِتَّةِ أَشْيَاءَ. Do you know what this great imam has said? أُغْلِقَ بَابُ التَّوْفِيقَ أغلق باب التوفيق عن الخلق في ستة أشياء. He said, because of six reasons, the door of guidance has actually been blocked from the people. Because of how many reasons? How many reasons altogether? Six reasons. And he's going to tell us these six reasons. If you memorize these six reasons tonight and you try not to be like these people, what's going to happen, inshallah ta'ala, you will be successful. The doors of success are blocked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of six reasons. Number one, he said, اشتغالهم بالنعمة عن شكرها. اشتغالهم بالنعمة عن شكرها. We have become busy with the blessings that Allah gave us, and we have become too busy to thank Allah. Who gave you the eyes? Allah, yeah? Do you thank Him for that? Who gave you the job you have? Who gave you the kids you have? Who gave you the car you're driving? Who gave you the house you have? Who gave you the wife? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But are we busy thanking Allah, or we are busy just because of our blessings. We're just busy with our blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. Look at what he said. Imagine, I'm just going to give you a story right now. Imagine if someone was invited to a house. Imagine you have invited someone to a house and he's your guest of honor. You welcomed him the best way possible. He walked into your house. You gave him the best of food. And then he sat down. He ate and ate and ate and ate without even looking at you in the eye. And then he walked out. How are you going to feel as a host? Are you going to be happy with that person or very unhappy? You're going to be very unhappy. Just imagine what we're doing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gave us everything and still we are very busy. In terms, we don't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're so ungrateful. And do you know what's going to happen in the akhirah? The ni'am that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us are so plentiful. Plentiful, too much. Look what's going to happen. A man is going to come. The nations before us. A man is going to come. And then when the angels like look at his a'mal and everything, he will be told to go to Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, let him enter Jannah because of my mercy. That man is going to say, oh Allah, I am not going to enter paradise because out of your mercy. I am going to enter paradise because I have worked for it. I have been worshipping you for 70 years. He said, I earned it. I worked hard for this, you know. Do you know what Allah is going to say to him? Come back. Allah right now is going to adjust the angels. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to adjust the angels right now. And Allah is going to say to the angels, I want you to weigh up and see which one is heavier. One single blessing which I gave him, one ni'mah, which is the ni'mah of the eyesight. And the 70 years he was worshipping me, weigh it up. And Allah, when the angels weigh it up, they will find out that the ni'mah of the eye and the ability to see is actually heavier than the 70 years he was worshipping Allah. And then Allah will say to the angels, now he has nothing left. Do you have anything else? No, you've got nothing else. Take him to the hellfire. You don't have enough ajr to go into Jannah with, you know? Take him to hellfire. Look at the ni'am Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. And we are so ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just remember that. So that's number one. If we don't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reason that the Muslims are lowest of the lowest today is, number one, like Shaqiq ibn Ibrahim has said, we are busy just messing about with the ni'mah Allah gave us and not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, look at what he said. Another one is amazing. وَرَغْبَتُهُمْ فِي الْعِلْمِ وَتَرْكُهُمُ الْعَمَلِ We love to, sometimes we love seeking ilm. We want to learn, we need knowledge. We love it, but we don't want to act upon it. How much do we see that? Someone who has knowledge, but he is not acting upon the knowledge that he has or she has. Is there anyone in this masjid who doesn't know that salah is obligatory upon them 5 times a day? All of us, we know that, yeah? Is there anyone who doesn't know telling a lie is haram? All of us, we know. How many of us memorize Juz Amma? Many of us. How many of us know this and that? We know a lot. And we seek knowledge. Because a lot of people right now, we seek knowledge in order to become important. And what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? If anyone seeks knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the knowledge of Akhirah, just in order to gain something in this world, he will not smell Ra'ihat al-Jannah. You will not even smell, mashallah, the fragrances of Jannah. You will not enter Jannah. But these days what happens? Many people seek knowledge in order just to gain power, influence, to make people look at them and love them, and that's it. And to get into position of power. That's what Shaqiq ibn Ibrahim has said. He said this is another reason why the Muslims are doing very, very bad. Very, very bad. And look at the third one. Each one of us will find some of these things in themselves. Look at number three. Number three, he said, وَالْمُسَارَعَةُ إِلَى الذَّنْبِ وَتَأْخِيرُ التَّوْبَةِ You hasten towards committing sins and you always put off the tawbah. You always say, I'm going to make tawbah next year, you know. Next year I'm going to go to Hajj. Akhi, why are you selling drugs? Akhi, wallahi, I know it's just not really that good. I know it's wrong, you know. But I've got to make a bit of money, you know. Okay, because I'm... And what, akhi, you could get into trouble with this. No. And I know what I'm doing, Sheikh. Don't worry about it. Okay, I know how to cover my sins, you know, how to cover it up. The police will never get me, you know. I'm so clever. Nobody's going to catch me. You forget you have angels with you. Do you know these angels? They're writing everything. They're not going to give you a break. The angel is not going to say, oh, mashallah, mashallah, I'm going to give you a break today. You can do whatever you want. No, angels will always be writing. And the angels, you can never deceive them. You can never give them money. The angels will always write everything. So what do? We hasten towards committing sins and we put the tawbah back. We say, we got to make, how many people died before they made tawbah? Many, many people. They died before they made tawbah. How many people have died while they were committing the sin? Do you know if you talk to the people who wash the dead people, they said, mashallah, the imams, the mashaykh, when they wash dead people, sometimes they see bad signs. They see bad signs from certain people. Some young people, when their bodies are being washed, something bad smell comes out of their bodies. Very bad smell. Their color changes. Their body becomes like very different. Why? Because they have died while they were doing something wrong. You don't want to die in that state. So the Sheikh has said, you are quick in committing sins, but when it comes to tawbah, you delay it and delay it and delay it until it's too late. Many people delay it, and then what happened? They died. And then they have no chance in akhirah. Finished. They've gone. So that's number three. Shall we come to the fourth one? The fourth one, he said, وَالْإِغْتِرَارُ بِصُحْبَةِ الصَّالِحِينَ وَتَرْكُ الْإِقْتِدَاءِ بِفِعَالِهِ. That's number four. I will repeat it again. وَالْإِغْتِرَارُ بِصُحْبَةِ الصَّالِحِينَ وَتَرْكُ الْإِقْتِدَاءِ بِفِعَالِهِ. That's number four. He said, these people, they are proud of being friends with the mashaykh. Have you seen people like that? Some people, they love to be around the mashaykh. Always you will see the mashallah. Yes, do you know when I was having my wedding, I'm going to invite Sheikh such and such. Sheikh such and such is going to come and he's going to do the aqd. And you know where the wedding is taking place at night? Sheraton Hotel. Girls, boys, everybody's mixed. Well, ya akhi, you have invited big Sheikh of the Sheikh of the city, and mashallah, you should be having a halal wedding, you know, at night time, everything is different. You're not acting like the Sheikh, but you claim to be the friend of the Sheikh. The Sheikh has said, look at this alim, what he said. He said, that's another reason why the Muslims are down here. We're not practicing our deen. Very serious, Ikhwani. Very, very serious. And look at the next one. وَإِدْبَارِ الدُّنْيَا عَنْهُمْ وَهُمْ يَتْبَعُونَهَا. This world is abandoning us. This dunya is doesn't want us, but we are running after dunya. We are jogging after dunya. Not running. We are not only jogging, we are running after dunya. And dunya is running away from us. Dunya is saying, guys, leave me alone, leave me alone. And you are jogging after this dunya. We are running after it. You know? Have you ever seen Sheikh who run away from the place? See, we are running after dunya. I have to show you physically exactly what I mean. Physically, people are running after this dunya. I'm not a fast runner, you know? If I run, it's going to take me like maybe a minute to get to that side, you know? Okay, so what I'm going to say to you right now, Ikhwani, is this. We are running after dunya. We are running what? After dunya. And dunya is saying, don't run after me. I don't want you guys. Just stay away from me. Okay, but we are running after it. And what is the last one? وَإِقْبَالُ الْآخِرَةِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ عَنْهَا. Akhirah is coming towards us, is drawing near. Akhirah is coming towards us. But we are turning away from Akhirah. And what did Ali radiallahu anhu, what did he used to say? He used to say, subhanallah, Akhirah, this dunya is leaving you. This dunya is leaving you. And Akhirah is drawing near to you. وَكُلُّ مِّنْهُمَا لَهُ بَنُونَ. Each one of them, Akhirah and Dunya, each one of them, it has its own sons. فَكُونُوا مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَكُونُوا مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ الدُّنْيَا. الْيَوْمَ عَمَلْ وَلَا حِسَابٌ غَدًا حِسَابٌ وَلَا عَمَلٌ. Very important. Ali radiallahu anhu, what did he used to say? Akhirah is coming towards you. Akhirah is coming. Because every day that we live, every second that we live, we are going towards Akhirah. And dunya is leaving us behind. Dunya is going that way, and we are going towards this way, which is Akhirah. Subhanallah. And look what is happening. As we draw near to Akhirah, we are still trying to run away from Akhirah. And what is Ali radiallahu anhu? What did he say? Today is action. and there's no reckoning, there's no hisab. But tomorrow, meaning inna ilayna iyabahum thumma inna alayna hisabahum. What did Allah say? Tomorrow, what's going to happen when you come back to us is going to be a time of accountability, a time of reckoning. Kullum ghadan hisabun wala amal. Tomorrow it's only just going to be hisab, reckoning, and there's no action. You cannot even say subhanallah one more time. Imagine when we get to akhirah. Can you say to the angels, excuse me please, can you just give me a time to pray two rak'ahs? Can you just give me a time to say subhanallah? You can't do that. Khalas, akhirah, nothing is going to be accepted from you. Subhanallah, nothing will be accepted from you. So that is the time which is ahead of us, ikhwani. But I want to give you one last thing, inshallah ta'ala. As I said, things will only improve if we hold on to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Very, very important. And I want to say to the brothers and the sisters, wallahi, there is no doctor in the world who can give you a prescription and who can say to you, I'm going to make you feel better. All of us as Muslims today, we are feeling the pain of the Ummah. We are feeling what? The pain of the Ummah. Those of you who attended the khutbah yesterday, when I was delivering the khutbah here, yesterday I was in the masjid. Those of you who have attended, probably you heard what I said. The mu'mineen, the believers, the Muslims around the world, many places, they're going through difficulties. And as Muslims, are we feeling the pain that they're feeling? Are we feeling the pain and the suffering that they are going through? Are we feeling the same thing? Are we feeling sorry for them? Are we trying to help them and so forth? I have even said yesterday, maybe some of the non-Muslims, our brothers and sisters in humanity, are sometimes feeling far more sorry for them than we are feeling for them. Look at that, subhanallah. How miserable, how bad our situation is. This is how bad our situation is as Muslims. And the reasons why we are lacking or falling behind is like Shaqiq ibn Ibrahim has just mentioned. These are the reasons, these six things I have mentioned. Who's gonna remind me number one of the six? Who remembers what was number one? Anybody who wants to try number one? Or any of it? Anyone of it? Yes? Number one was not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the good things He gave us. Well done. What is number two? Who remembers? Any order? Yes, looking for knowledge but not acting upon the knowledge. What was number three? This is very important. Where do we run towards? Yeah, exactly. We're running towards sin, but we are putting off tawbah. We are saying tawbah, I'm going to make tawbah tomorrow. And what was number four? Number four was, no, not before that. What was number four? What? We love the mashayikh, to be with the mashayikh, but we are not acting like them. What was number five? Running after dunya, and dunya is running away from us. And what was the last one? Akhirah is coming. Exactly. Okay, Akhirah is coming towards us, but we are running away from Akhirah. Subhanallah, these are the reasons. And I want to say this to you, brothers and sisters in Islam. If we can see ourselves in one of these six things I mentioned, if we are not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enough, make tawbah to Allah tonight and say, I want to thank Allah for all the things He gave me. Be grateful to Allah. From tonight, say, I'm going to thank Allah because of what He gave me, everything He gave me. If you have a car, say, Alhamdulillah, this car is from Allah. The job you have, thank Allah for that job. And say, Alhamdulillah, Allah gave me this job. It's not because of your intelligence. If you are a doctor and sitting right now here, do not think because of your intelligence you became a doctor. It is the blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are an engineer right now, do not think because you are clever, that's why you are an engineer. If you are an accountant, don't think because you are clever, that's why you have become an accountant. If you are whatever you are, remember, it's only Allah who made you what you have become. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave you the permission to become like that. Like Shu'aib alayhi salam has said, وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. He said, only Allah gives me the guidance that I have. Allah is the one who guided him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives us that guidance to do what we have to do. So inshallah ta'ala, brothers, I want to conclude by saying this. Inshallah ta'ala, let us make tawbah to Allah. each and every one of us and say, I want to do better than I was doing before, inshallah ta'ala, before I came to the masjid today. And when you leave, shaitan, who's waiting outside, he's going to be very upset. Because you're going to make, shall we make shaitan cry tonight? Raise your hand. How many of us want to make Iblis cry tonight? Raise your hand. Ya doni Iblis in manta in kohisin. All of us, we want to make Iblis cry right now. Yes? How can we make Iblis cry? By making sure when you leave the masjid, you are better than how you were the time that you walked into the masjid. All of us, we want to make Iblis cry. And that's exactly what we're going to do, inshallah ta'ala. Therefore, my brothers and sisters in Islam, it has been a pleasure to be with you, inshallah ta'ala. And I want to say to you, mashallah, it has been a great, mashallah, gathering to be here, to be with my brothers and sisters in Islam in this part of the world, mashallah, in Gothenburg, in Masjid Ahl Sunnah. And mashallah, it has been a great time for me to come. And hopefully, I will see you another time, inshallah ta'ala. And I hope this is not our last meeting. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasn't written that we're going to meet up again here, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring us together in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. Say, Ameen, inshallah ta'ala. May we meet in Firdaws al-A'la, inshallah ta'ala. And that's the important one. That's the important place of meeting. Because if we go to Jannah, inshallah ta'ala, we will forget everything else, inshallah. Jannah is where we want to go. But do you know the people, the salihin, the real salihin, one of the, mashallah, one of the salaf has said, rak'atayn, he said, two rak'ats that I pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more beloved to me than Jannah and everything that's in it. People were shocked. People have said to him, what are you talking about? He said, what? Two rak'ats that I pray for Allah, he said, is better to me and I feel better by praying two rak'ats for Allah than actually having Jannah and everything that's in it. And the people have said to him, that's not right. How can he say that? He said, I'll tell you why I've said that. And do you know why he said that? He said, when I go to Jannah, he said, I'm the one who's going to be happy. But he said, when I pray two rak'ahs for Allah, Allah is the one who's going to be happy. SubhanAllah. That's the difference. Look how he understood. Look at how he understood, mashallah, the deen. So inshallah ta'ala, that's how we should be thinking, inshallah. We should have that mentality, inshallah ta'ala. Guys, and also remember, don't just say, what can Islam do for me? Remember to say, what can I do for Islam? What can I do for the Muslims? How can I help the Muslims? Remember that, inshallah ta'ala. Each and everyone, one of the ways of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to help other people, to help humanity. Because the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. Some of the ulama, they say, the akh that is mentioned here, the brother that is mentioned here, is not only the Muslim brother, is the brother in humanity. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. Our religion is a universal religion. وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. The Prophet ﷺ was rahmah and mercy to everybody, to everyone in mankind, mashallah. This is the universality of our religion and the beauty of our religion. Our religion is not barbaric. Young people, our religion is not barbaric. Our religion is not about killing people. Our religion is about peace. Our religion is about bringing people together. Our religion is about loving khair for other people. Loving khair for other people and hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring us together. Until I see you next time, inshallah ta'ala. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.